Good afternoon, everyone. Allow me the opportunity to extend condolences to my friend Noor and Noordina and Noreen. So much has been said, and I don't want to eulogize Noordina any further, except to say that she was indeed a Proverbs 31 woman. And I love that quote that I heard from Sister Robert. There is no religion without service. And that's the way she lived her life, because it is service that gives life to religion. Without service, religion is mere formality. So I thank God and praise God for her service. This afternoon, I've chosen a passage for meditation that I believe is full of hope. It's found in the book of Job, the 19th chapter. Reading from verse 23. Let's just bow our heads in a moment of meditation before we get into God's word. Father, we give thanks for this opportunity of celebrating the life of an authentic woman of God. We thank you for her service, for the life that she touched. And now as we focus on your word, may it give us strength and courage. Give us beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, and the garment of praise for a spirit of heaviness. And may all the glory and the honor and the praise be to you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Job chapter 19. I'll read it in your hearing from the New King James Version. It says, "Oh, that my words were written. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. That they were engraved on a rock with an iron pen and lead forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. How my heart yearns within me." You know, Job, this patriarch, made this bold declaration of his faith in God and God's word at a time when the odds were stacked up against him. At a time when the facts of his life could have easily led him to think and believe and feel that God was not on his side. What were the facts of his life? Here was a man who had lost all his possessions and all his children in tragic circumstances overnight. Here was a man who was afflicted with putrefying sores from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. Here was a man who, because of his circumstances, had become the subject of ridicule and abuse by everyone, rejected by his brothers, his acquaintances, his close friends, his servants, his wife, the children in the neighborhood, and all those whom he loved. His three best friends, who knew him well and knew the type of person he was, were accusing him of being a wicked man, because of their belief that misfortunes and tragedies like this could only happen to those who were wicked. In their minds, Job had to have done something terribly wrong to experience this tragedy. These were the facts of his life. You see, in life, there are facts, and there is truth. I want to tell you that facts are relative and dynamic. Facts are the situations and the experiences that we encounter from day to day. Facts may be good or bad. They may bring happiness or sorrow. And when we focus on the facts of our lives, our perspective on life and relationships keep changing. But I'm saying this afternoon that while the facts of our lives are relative and dynamic and constantly changing, I want to tell you that truth is absolute, it is constant, it is stable, it is unchanging, because truth comes from God and His Word. You see, when Job's wife considered the facts of their life, she told him to curse God and die. But he called her a foolish woman because he preferred to hold on to the truth that his Redeemer lived than to allow the circumstances and facts of his life to take away his sure hope of redemption and restoration promised by his Redeemer in the last day. You know, today it is so easy to dwell on this fact of our lives, on this sudden, untimely loss of a mother, a wife, a friend, a colleague. But I'm saying on the authority of the Word of God that if we allow this to overwhelm and consume us, it has the potential to lead us into an abyss of hopelessness, away from the truth that God loves us and cares for us. You see, the truth says that Jesus bore our griefs and carried our sorrows because he was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. The truth says that he was touched by the feelings of our infirmities. So he can identify with us in our grief and our sorrow. The truth of God's word admonishes us in 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 and 14, not to sorrow as those who have no hope. Because it gives us the guarantee that because Jesus died and rose again, God will bring with him Sister Punch as she sleeps in Jesus this afternoon. Oh yes, the truth assures us that even now, God is working through the facts, the circumstances of our lives, which seem to be working against us now. But he's going to turn these eventually into a blessing for our own good. He does it every time. I want to say to my friend Nord, I sat 8 years ago where you're sitting, and I can identify with the pain and the grief. But God is good. God is good no matter which way the wind blows. I want you to remember that. And I want to encourage you to take your time to grieve. Take all the time you need to grieve. Now, Job did not understand, he did not deserve all this hardship and suffering and loss. But you know, he, like us, was living in a world where you don't get what you deserve. We are living in a world where life deals some hard blows to good, nice people. And we've got to be prepared. Because the sad reality is that misfortune and loss, suffering and death will one day come knocking at your door. And when it does, you will not only need friends and loved ones to support you, but like Job, you will need to have the confidence that your Redeemer lives. And that he has the power and the will to turn your circumstances around for your own good. And to restore not only what you have lost, but infinitely more. But until he does, we'll continue to suffer loss and misfortune and tragedy and death. And we'll have to trust the wisdom and the judgment of an all-knowing God and Redeemer who never makes mistakes, but loves and cares for his children. And he works in all situations for the good of those who love him. That's his promise, who have been called according to his purpose. Now Job had an understanding of the uncertainty of life. and its changing fortunes and circumstances. He was aware that as long as we live in this world, we'll have to face joy and sorrow, and riches and poverty, and health and sickness, and friendship and enmity, hope and despair, life and death. But he was also aware that even though life's situations and circumstances may change and deal us some sorrowful blows, his Redeemer never changed. He was convinced that the truth of God's love was so constant and so unchanging that nothing could separate him from the love of God. And that's why he could afford to call his wife a foolish woman, because he believed in the love of God. Observe that Job said in verse 25, "For I know." For I know. Now, you know, the irony of this is that his friends had accused him of ignorance and vain knowledge. But Job certainly knew something they didn't. He knew that he had a living Redeemer. And that knowledge gave him the hope of restoration. You see, in the time of Job, there was a law called the law of redemption. And that law guaranteed that after every 50 years, slaves would be freed and returned to their families. That law guaranteed that all property that was sold would return to their original owner. This was a law of restoration. And it guaranteed that this restoration would take place after 50 years. Now, this 50th year was called the year of Jubilee.
That's right.
And during that time, every Israelite celebrated restoration and liberty. But you know, 50 years was a long time to wait for restoration and liberty. And because some wouldn't live to see the next Jubilee, to repossess their lands, or to be reunited with their families, this same gracious law of redemption also gave the right to a close living relative who had the means and who was debt-free to buy back or redeem land or slaves and restore them to their owners and to their families before the 50th year of Jubilee. Now, this close relative was called a goel, or Redeemer. But you know, Job, when he declared this wonderful truth, understood that the law of redemption was not merely talking about an earthly close relative who would restore everything he had lost. You see, he had a clear understanding that that law was given to teach the vital truth that a Redeemer would come to bring about the eternal restoration of all things. And that's why Job was able to look beyond the facts and the circumstances of his life of suffering, beyond the earthly restoration of the year of Jubilee. He had a vision, a 2020 vision that looked way beyond 50 years, yes, to the day of final and absolute redemption, when mortality would give way to immortality and corruption to incorruption. Observe what he said in verses 25 to 27. He said, "For I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God." Oh yes, his outward man was perishing, but his inner spirit was being renewed day by day, because he looked down and he saw his Redeemer standing in the last day. And he said, "I know that in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself. And my eyes shall behold, and not another." How my heart yearns, how my heart longs for this day. Job knew that because his Redeemer was alive, no circumstance, no situation, nothing that his friends told him could shake his confidence in the truth of his Redeemer's promise of the final restoration of all things. That's why he was able to declare in Job, in the 13th chapter of his book and the 15th verse, he says, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Even so, I will defend my own ways before him." And also Job 14. Verses 13 through 15, he said, "Oh, that you could hide me in the grave, that you would conceal me until your wrath is past, that you would appoint me a set time and remember me.
Yes.
If a man dies, shall he live again?
Yes.
All the days of my heart service I will wait till my change comes.
Yes.
You shall call, and I will answer you.
Yes.
You shall desire the work of your hands.
Amen.
Oh, what faith, what indomitable faith and courage Job had in his Redeemer. You know, this afternoon I'm happy that Sister Modena also believed in this Redeemer. She believed in the hope of final restoration. You see, she had received her knowledge of this Redeemer and the hope of final restoration from faithful parents. I had the privilege of being their pastor for a short while in Tobago. So I knew her parents, and the fruit doesn't fall far from the tree. So I can understand why she grew up to be the kind of person she was, because her parents were authentic Christians too.
Amen.
And they were faithful servants in the church at Goodwood.
Amen.
So Modena had that upbringing. She had the benefit of that upbringing. That's why she lived for Jesus from childhood to youth to adolescence to adulthood. And that's why her life was so purposeful and fulfilling. She lived to serve and bless and touch the lives of so many.
Amen.
And that's why she gave such faithful and committed service to the women and children and the constituency and the community of Grenada. And even though we don't have any explanation or reason for her sudden demise, we trust God's wisdom.
Yes.
We trust His timing.
Amen.
We trust His omniscience.
Yes.
And we trust His love. Because we know He loved her more than we could ever have loved.
Yes.
So God, who knows all things,
right,
and sees the bigger picture, in His mercy and providence, has chosen this time to relieve her of the burdens and cares of this life.
Yes.
By putting her to rest, to wait for the coming of her Redeemer.
Yes.
Who will restore all things eternally.
Yes.
That's why she lies so peacefully this afternoon. And I'm confident that when Jesus appears in the last day to wake up His sleeping saints, Modena will hear His call and rise up in the first resurrection. You see, it is not so much dying that is a tragedy, but it is dying without God, dying without a Redeemer. That's the tragedy. That's why we all need to choose that Redeemer this afternoon. For without Him, there is absolutely no hope of restoration. But with Him, there is the certainty of a return to life. And not just life, but hallelujah, everlasting life. A life of eternal freedom from sorrow and loss and pain and tears and sickness and tragedy and death. So this afternoon, I submit that Jesus is qualified to be your Redeemer.
Glory, glory.
Because you see, He has fulfilled all the criteria mentioned in that Old Testament law of redemption and restoration. You see, first of all, the Redeemer who could restore freed slaves to their families and repurchase and restore property that was sold to the original owner, He had to be a close relative. That's why Jesus is qualified to be your Redeemer this afternoon. Because He's a close relative of ours. And He became such 2,000 years ago when He took on human flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth, hallelujah, so that we could rejoice in the hope of His restoration. Secondly, the Redeemer had to possess the means and the resources to redeem His relative before the 50th year, and He had to be debt free. Well, I'm saying that Jesus is qualified to be our Redeemer.
Amen.
Because He had the means to redeem us. And He was also debt free. You see, as the creator of the heavens and the earth, He is the owner of everything. Psalm 24:1 declares that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The world and all that dwell therein, as the good old Negro spiritual says, He's got the whole world in His hands. So He has the means. Praise God. Thirdly, the Redeemer had to be willing to pay the price to redeem His relative. You remember when
what was his name? Naomi's cousin, Boaz. Boaz was a redeemer, right? But there was a relative who was closer than to Naomi than Boaz. And he went and he gave that relative the opportunity to do the purchase. You remember that, don't you? Well, I'm saying that Boaz was ready and willing to pay the price to redeem his relative. And the good news this afternoon is that Jesus is qualified to be our redeemer because he was willing to pay the price, and he did pay the price when he died on the cross to set us free from the slavery and the dominion of sin, and so that we could be restored to full fellowship with God, our creator and rightful owner. And I thank God that he's a living redeemer. Because a redeemer would be of no use to us. While we are dying, he lives. Friends may die. Loved ones may die. Brothers, sisters, mothers, fathers, husbands, wives, sons and daughters may die. And when they do, we may think that they are gone forever. But thank God they are not gone forever, because our Redeemer is alive. And we have the guarantee that since he lives, we too shall live. You see, it gives blessed consolation and assurance to know that when tragedy strikes us, we have a Redeemer who is alive. I say it gives me abundant hope to know that even though the facts of our situation tell us that we have lost a wife and a mother and an aunt and a friend and a neighbor and a colleague, I want to remind you that the truth this afternoon tells us that we have not lost our Redeemer. He is alive. And this means that Sister Punch will be set free from the shackles of death and restored to us at the coming of our Redeemer and Savior Jesus Christ. And this blessed truth is our guarantee that we shall see her again, because her Redeemer and ours has already paid the price. And the amazing thing about this restoration, hallelujah, it's not going to be a restoration to life as we know it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes,
Pastor.
Yes, sir.
It will be a restoration to life as God designed it to be originally.
Amen, amen.
And Job knew that. And he believed that. And he looked forward to that with such longing and desire. He said, oh, how my heart yearns within me. How I long for that day.
Yeah.
Oh, beloved, this afternoon my heart yearns within me too.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why, notwithstanding the facts of our life, like Job, I prefer to hold on to the truth that God has promised a day of redemption and restoration when we will see Jesus face to face. And in that day of redemption, we will be delivered from the dangerous streets of this world, where people rape and rob and kill one another. We'll be delivered from the crime and the violence all around us. Oh yes, that day of redemption will bring about deliverance and freedom from everything that causes hurt and sorrow and tears and misery to God's children. It will bring about eternal change and restoration. I tell you, there's going to be a change in the air. For there will be no more air pollution. There'll be a change in the earth, because the curse of sin will be forever removed. There'll be a change in our bodies, for this mortal will put on immortality, and this corruptible will put on incorruption. And we'll be able to run and not get tired, and walk and not faint, and just change. The Bible tells us, the truth of God's word tells us, that will take place in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. You know, a minute takes 60 seconds, but a moment is measured in milliseconds. In fact, the text says that the change will happen in the twinkling of an eye. You see, when your eye winks, it happens so fast that it doesn't even cut your vision. All it does is lubricate your eyeball. That's how fast the change is going to take place in the bodies of the redeemed, when Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, returns on that glorious day of restoration. In that day, Sister Smaller, you wouldn't need that cane anymore. For the lame will throw away their crutches.
Yes.
And the bent and twisted backs will straighten up.
Yes.
And the deaf are going to hear.
Yes.
And the dumb will speak.
Yes.
And the blind will go sightseeing.
Yes.
And the redeemed are going to take the place that has been left vacant by the devil and his angels in heaven.
Yes.
You see, there's a vacancy in heaven right now.
Yes.
But I tell you that God is going to fill that vacancy with human beings who used to be sinners, human beings who used to be liars and thieves and adulterers and murderers, but because they have believed in Jesus their Redeemer and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb, they will be transformed into his likeness. Hallelujah. And our Redeemer, Jesus Christ, has made it possible for all of us to be a part of that glorious hereafter.
Amen.
Where God will wipe away all tears from our eyes. Where you'll abolish sorrow and death and crying and pain forevermore. Oh yes, he has planned that day with you in mind.
Yes.
He has planned that day with Modena in mind.
Yes.
And he's making it available to all who want it.
Amen.
Do you want it?
Yes.
Glory.
Do you want it as badly as Job wanted it?
Yes.
Well, it's available to only those who want it. So I pray God that all of us will desire it above everything else, so that we can live to see our Redeemer face to face. Face to face shall we behold him. That's my prayer and my wish for my friend Maud and his family and relatives and friends and all of us here this afternoon, that we'll be ready to meet our Redeemer. God bless you.
We thank God for that wonderful word of hope. I invite you please to stand for the prayer of comfort. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings of this day. A day of mixed blessings. For whereas we rejoice in the blessed hope, the reality is that we need comfort.
Yes.
And we are happy that you are the basis of our hope, and you are the source of our comfort.
Amen.
We thank you, God, for the life and influence of your daughter, Modena. And, oh God, even as in your own providence, we have to admit it's beyond us. The pain is indeed real, the loss is severe. We come to you thanking you, Lord, for your word. Your word, as presented this afternoon, has given us a clearer perspective of your truth. It helps us to even ride over the facts of life. And Lord, as we come to you, we come with the understanding that you have given us such assurance, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, many mansions, if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again.
Yes.
Until that time, O God, I pray that you would be with your son, Dr. Norwood, and those lovely daughters, Alina and Nordina. O God, I pray that you will give them comfort. Let them know that they have done their best and they are not to be blamed for this. An enemy has brought death to our world, but that enemy has already been conquered. And so we look forward with hope and eager anticipation to that glorious day of reunion. Watch over all the workers here and members here of this church and community of Grenada, Dr. Lewis and his team. The grief is great. We could have heard it this evening, and it has been evident, for one of the family of God has been laid to rest. And even in our mourning, in our grieving, let us understand that we are doing it with hope.
Amen.
Hope that one day soon, we shall see her again.
Amen.
Keep us faithful, O God. May we live with that understanding that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And what he has done for her, he will continue to do for us. O God, may we indeed be found faithful, so that ultimately, when you choose to come again, as your word declares, we will hear you say to all of us, well done.
Amen.
Enter into the joy of thy Lord. It's our prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated.
When you stay, everything will work out fine.